Well, amen. It's good to see everybody here today. Glad you came out to the Lord's house on Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day to all our mamas. I know there's people with their moms today, and it's a blessing. Glad to have my mama here with me today. And for those of you whose moms are in heaven today, we pray that you'll have a good day. I know missing folks and missing people is a tough thing. I think one of the greatest things that we have now is our memories and able to remember good things. And I was talking to a coach this past week, and he and I grew up together, and I told him, I said, you know, the older we get, it seems like some of the best things that we have is the remembering of good times when we saw God do things, and we saw and knowing that he could do it again if he decides to. So thank you for all that, for all of you coming here today. Happy Mother's Day. I have a card to read this morning from Brother Kenny and Miss Kathy Ivy. Said, I would like to thank each and every one that paid to get my van fixed. Words cannot describe what it means to me. Thank you also for those who drove the van home and back to the shop. May God bless y'all. Amen. Said, you made our little corner of the world a happier place to be in. Amen. So thank you. It was an honor to do that. This morning, Miss Trina is going to come up, and she's got some gifts for some of our mothers before we get started.
Good morning, everybody. Are y'all super excited? Did all the men remember today was Mother's Day and you got a great meal planned out and peace and quiet for the mamas? Okay, if you didn't, you need to be working on that while you're in church. Just kidding. Listen to Brother Ray. Don't not listen to him. Okay, so every Mother's Day, we always have gifts for all the mothers. They are in the back, but we also like to honor several mothers this morning. And our first one is going to be Miss Carol Thrift. She is not only our oldest mother, but a strong beacon in our church. She said she's the best. She's the best. Miss Vicki says she's the best, Mama. And the next gift that I would like to give out is to the mother that has the most children. Miss Patsy back there says she has the most children. If you have any kids in this church and they go home wired out, it's because they have been in her candy bag. Okay? So do we have any mamas here that have 10 kids? Because if we do, you are a huge blessing. 9? 8? 7? Miss Carol has 8? Holy. Ronnie's shaking his head. No, you are not the best. Ronnie said he's the best. Since we've already recognized Miss Carol, do we have anybody that has 7? 6? 5? Now, come on, where is Lainey? Miss Cindy back there, Miss Cindy Veely. Miss Patricia, how many of you got? 5? Separate them. Mm-hmm. Okay. And so I don't take up the whole service with asking 20 million questions. The rest of them, I've kind of prayed about it and asked God to lay different people on my heart so that they can be blessed individually. My first person is going to be Miss Michelle Boyd. My second person is Cindy Carter. The third person is going to be Miss Angela Hodges. The next person is going to be Janet Pitts. And my next person is Miss Vicki Carter, and I think she is in the back maybe getting ready for all the kids for Children's Church. She does a great job with that, and the kids love it. So when we see her, remind her that one of these bags up here is hers. And the last person, but definitely not the least, is Miss Tiny Thrift. Y'all can't see it from there, but there's a couple of people that give me funky looks this morning because they don't care to be recognized, but they are strong people in our church, and we just want them to know that we love them, we appreciate all the work that they do, and that we appreciate the great kids that they've raised, and they're doing great things for the Lord. I also want to say today, as we go through Mother's Day, remember the two mamas that lost their babies this week. Raymond had been to our church several times, and I can't for the life of me imagine how heartbroken that mama is this morning. And then we have, in Brantley County, a sixth grader whose mama has to go through Mother's Day today after her son was in an accident. So if we could remember those mamas and lift those families up in our prayers, because that's not something that anybody should have to go through. So I just want to say thank you. Ladies, don't forget that your gifts are in the back, and I hope everybody has a great and blessed Mother's Day.
And about all these ladies' gifts, Brother Ronnie come in today. Us men need to have us something. We get us some gifts. There's a gift table for the ladies in the back. There's a gift table for the ladies at Walmart. There's a gift table for the women over here. Listen. Yeah, but there won't be no gifts. Hey, listen, Mother's Day, Miss Shug gets like a month. I get like an afternoon between 4 and 5. That's it. Men, look around. We want us some presents, don't we? Look at it. And we do like to whine and complain, so that's our right. Anyway, next Sunday is graduation Sunday. Parents of seniors, please turn in pictures in for a slideshow by the 4th. I hope you got them already. My announcement's late. To Miss Katrina, the youth camp is June 26th through the 30th. There'll be a parent meeting after the AM service this morning in the youth room for youth camp. Deposits are due today. VBS is July 24th through the 28th. Looking for a good week of VBS. Youth, got that already. Also, the youth are selling raffle tickets for a 12-gauge shotgun. They're $20 each. If you'd like to be involved with that, please let them know or get with some of the kids and get a ticket. They're going to sell those until next Sunday. Any other announcements? Any prayer requests?
This is about graduation. Be sure to be here at 10:15. Meet the youth room with your cat.
Okay, 10:15. Miss Martha Lee passed away. I know a lot of you may know Miss Martha, but remember her family. Any others?
Eldon Mix and his family.
Remember Mr. Eldon Mix and his family? Brother Weaver from the Homeland Pentecostal Church passed away this week. We've been praying for him, and he was in pretty bad shape, but he preached right to the end. Right till the end. Pentecostal. Amen. Anybody else?
Jesse Richmond's family.
Any others? Yes, sir.
My brother.
Yes, ma'am. Remember Wayne Aldridge? Remember Brother Pete? Also remember Mr. Jack, Miss Rita Howe? Remember Brother Tracy? Miss Kay, any others? Any unspoken this morning? What was his name?
Bentley Gibson.
If I'd be glad to go out there, let me know. I'll be glad to go And I'm sure there's a lot of other youth guys in Brantley that would too. So if we can help, please let us know. Any others? Let's pray. Lord, this morning we come to you with hearts that are heavy on Mother's Day, God. We're thankful for our mothers and, Lord, the gifts that we have in those. And we're just thankful, God, that we can be here today to celebrate that. But, Lord, today we just lift up those that are hurting. Lord, young people, Lord, have left this world today. Lord, not sure how or why or the reasons behind things, God, but you know everything and your ways are perfect. Help us, God, to see you and what's going on. I just pray, Lord, that you'll strengthen those friends that are around, those that have passed this past week, Lord, and the families that are around them, Lord. I just pray you'll give them peace and understanding in the midst of all of this. For those mamas today, God, I just pray you'll be beside them. And I pray for a family network of love and peace around them as well today. Thank you for all the blessings we see here at our church and the people in it. Help us, God, not to take any day for granted and to realize, God, that every moment's precious. We love you, and it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. If you would visit around just for a second.
Great to be in the Lord's house this morning. If you would, please remain standing as we worship. Just one touch, my when we sing. My heart can't help but believe
there's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do.
Just one word,
you heal what's broken inside me. Just one word,
and you revive every dream.
Just one touch, I feel the power of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes are open to see. My heart can't help but believe there's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a prison wall He can't break through. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do.
I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus.
I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like His power. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Oh, there's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a prison wall He can't break through. Oh, praise the name makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do.
Jesus. Jesus, there's nothing impossible.
Celebrate Mother's Day and the mother we have here and the mother that's gone on, Lord. We just want to honor you and bless you through it all, Lord. As we come to a part of the service to give back just a small portion of your blessing that you've given us, Lord, we just ask that you bless this tithe and offering and bless the giver. I pray that we would use it for your work on this earthly ministry in Christ's name. Amen.
What a beautiful name it is.
sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is.
Well, amen. Take your Bibles with you. Turn to Luke chapter 1. This week, I failed to mention earlier, I didn't do it on purpose, but I had failed to mention that Sky will be competing this week in Michigan at the Junior Olympics. So keep Sky in your prayers this week. I think she competed this past week, but keep her in your prayers as she competes, and you represent us, so. Amen. To get you a, put you an Oak Hill thing on your jacket on the back. Something like that would be great. But amen. Take your Bibles and turn to Luke chapter 1, verse 26. Luke chapter 1, verse 26. When you find that, please stand with me for the reading of God's word. Luke chapter 6. I'm sorry, chapter 1, verse 6. Yeah, whichever way you want to turn, just listen. It'll be fine with me. Luke chapter 1, verse 26. Some of y'all don't hear very good. I'm already ill about the present, so don't push it. Amen. Luke chapter 1, verse 26 says this. And in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God into a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou art highly favored. The Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. Verse 29 says, And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and he shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Lord, we love you and we thank you for your word. We thank you for the power that's in it. We thank you, God, as that power imbues our life. Lord, help us to ever be thankful that we have it to read. I pray, God, today as we study your word, that we look at the life of Mary, a young mother-to-be, God, who's afraid. I pray you'll bless us with the reading. I pray you'll bless us today as we listen. In Jesus' name, amen. If you would be seated. In the very first part of this chapter, I was reading this past week, and my message this week was late in coming. I don't know why. I think for all the things that we saw towards the end of the week, the pain and the suffering, and I had one idea towards the beginning of the week, but this is where God sent me, my prayer is that we touch on some things, not just for mothers, but for all of us. A lot of things that we look at on Mother's Day, and we preach a Mother's Day sermon, and we talk about, okay, these are good for mothers. These are good for mothers. But listen, these are good for all of us. So as we touch on a few things today, my prayer is that it'll affect you in a way that will make you look on the inside. You know, today, some of our biggest failures, I guess, is we don't look on the inside of ourselves and are truthful. We look in and we see problems with everybody else in the world, but not our own selves. We find out that through the grapevine that somebody doesn't like us or somebody doesn't like this, and we get aggravated because that one said this about us or that one said that, or they didn't even say anything to me the whole time I was there, you know. I was talking to a young man last night, and people was asking questions about something, and he said, do you know what they're talking about? I said, no. He said, do you care? I said, no. He said, why? I said, because the more I know, the more I'm liable for. I said, my favorite retort is, I've no idea. I said, that way I'm not responsible. Yeah, I just don't know. And so I got to listening to him, and somebody asked him, he'd say, I've no idea. He was about 16 years old. And he was asking him questions about different things. His sisters was about to worry him to death, and finally, he said, I've no idea. And they left him alone. I said, it works, see? He said, thank you. So he learned something at 16. It took me 53 years to get, you know. I don't want any information. Just let me do my stuff, amen? But this morning, I want to leave you with some information that might help you out. My prayer is you'll see some things here. Look with me in the first part of this. It's okay to be afraid. It's okay to be afraid. Some of you are going through seasons in your life where you've been fearful and afraid. I look across this room and I see a hodgepodge of different lives and different things. Some of you has lost a spouse in the past year, a couple of years. Some of you embarking on new relationship, brand new. There's things to be that are fearful or fearful, but anxious about. And some of us maybe have found that you're not bulletproof anymore, and that you're not immortal, but mortal, and knees hurt, and backs hurt, now you have doctor visits and things like that, and you're fearful about some things. It's okay to be afraid this morning. I want to tell you, it's okay to be afraid. There's probably people in this room right now that you're looking at some instance or some thing in your life that you'd say, I'm fearful about this thing. Let's look at this right here very quick. In verse 26, the Bible says that the angel, the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God into the city of Galilee, named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph, in the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. So an angel came and saw Mary. When Mary was greeted by the angel Gabriel, she was struck with fear. The Bible says here that when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, because he said this to her. He said, Hail, thou art highly favored. The Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. She probably missed the favored part, or that you're a lucky girl. She probably missed that part because he had to say it again. You know, two verses down, he says again, you're favored, and had to repeat it because he's probably in awe that the angel of the Lord showed up in physical form to talk to her and to bring her a message. Now, she was fearful and she was afraid. Why was she afraid? Well, you say, well, it's because the angel has shown up. Or could it be that just a young middle teenage girl was being told that she was going to be pregnant here in the next little while, and that she was going to have to carry a child, and she hadn't known a man, so she was going to have to carry the rebuke of the whole people that saw her? You think that might have been part of it? Probably so. So let's look here a little further. It's okay to be afraid. When she saw him, she was troubled at his saying and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. Listen, in the midst of your fears, in the midst of the troubles that you go through in a day's time, let me tell you, your greatest thing that you can have is favor. You want God's favor in your life, no matter what happens, no matter what goes on. Listen, you might look at things in your life and you said, well, you see it as a failure, but listen, God might see it as favor. You might see something as an obstacle, but God might see it as an opportunity in your life. You might see things that happen. You say, I just don't think that God's 900 miles. Listen, the way God does things and the way that you do things may be polar opposite. So the best thing you can do is realize that God's in charge, he knows everything, and that the best thing you can do is find yourself faithful so that you can have favor with our Heavenly Father. Listen, I want favor. I want when God looks at old Brother Ray that he gives Brother Ray a word for you. I want when God looks, sees Brother Ray that I get 200,000 miles out of a pair of tires on my truck. Listen, I want favor. Anybody else? You say, oh, that's silly. I believe God looks out for us. Hey, listen, I've had vehicles break down on me before, and they broke down in my yard or always somewhere where it was not a problem. I've never had anything break somewhere far off where I had to get a wrecker to come get me. You say, well, I have. Well, I'm found favor. Amen? Hey, you say, that's silly. No, I try to see God in every single thing. Every single thing. I look back, and when I first got saved, me and Miss Shug, we had just enough money to make our little payments on our stuff that we had, and we were in church and doing everything God called us to do, and had a little Nissan pickup truck, and wouldn't you know, the starter went out on that thing. I had driven it down to Jacksonville. I was doing some side work, air conditioning work that I do all the time, but I was doing some side work, and I was running around. I parked it that Friday evening from driving all week long working out of it, worked it wide open, worked in the evenings, going out, doing stuff. And I parked that car Saturday morning. I went to get in it to run uptown and get something, and starter was bad. So I called my pa-in-law. He came over and picked me up and went to town, got a starter, come back and put it on it. The Lord told me the very next Sunday morning I was there, the Lord said, I could have had that thing break in Jacksonville yesterday. You said, Brother Ray, that's silly. Oh, no, it's not. I have favor. I have favor. You see, when I think about all the things that God has blessed us with and all the things that he does on our behalf that we don't even recognize, could it be that God's doing things in our lives and wanting recognition for it that we just don't give him? Could it be that God's doing so many things around us to make our lives complete and happy and whole, and we still don't give him any praise for it? Listen, it's okay to be afraid in this world that we're living in, because there's some days that are dark. Mary never criticized God for her situation. I've read through here. Not one time do you find where Mary whined and complained about the rebuke and the retribution she probably shared from all of her friends, all of her people. Can you imagine her telling all of her friends that she was pregnant, but she'd never been with a man, that the child was from God? Yeah. Imagine somebody saying that today. Everybody's probably just, yeah, yeah, yeah. See, they were looking for the coming of the Messiah, but she had one that was in her corner. It was a cousin who was already too old to have children. So let's look at a few things here. She said, the angel said, behold, thou shalt conceive and thy womb bring forth the son and shalt call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and his name shall be called the Son of the Highest. She was given this great burden to bear at such a young age, but she did it. She never backed up, and she did it in such a way that brought honor to God. Mamas, are we bringing honor to God today with our lives? Do you realize she set all her wants and desires aside for that child? Hey, listen, I'm not just on mamas. Daddy should too. Hey, a lot of times we think that we're owed things in this life and that there's some things that we should want and we ought to have this. Can I tell you, growing up, and I might just be different, but I can't remember my mom and daddy ever having many hobbies except raising youngins. I look back and I can remember the things that we did that we enjoyed the most. We all did it, and we all enjoyed it the most. Our lives revolved around things down at the church house. We don't do things that way today. Maybe that's what's wrong. Amen. Maybe that's what's wrong, that we don't do things down around God's house anymore. Maybe we think it's important that our child's able to compete with everybody down at the schoolhouse. Listen, best thing you can do is have your child down there at God's house so they can compete against the devil when he comes by to try to destroy them in their lives. Listen, we're raising a bunch of kids today that are now in their 20s and 30s that thinks that somebody's supposed to still bail them out of everything. Listen, they say the work. I was preparing a sermon a few weeks ago that I never preached, but the amount of people starting businesses today, 50 years ago, the average new business owner starting a new business was 28 years old, 50 years ago. Average new business owner. You know what average new business owner is today? 56. Young people aren't starting businesses anymore. Listen, I don't know where it's come from. Don't know where this generation is going. Don't know why they're doing it the way they do it. I have no idea. What I do know is we're in a mess out here in this world. Amen. And listen, and what we need more than anything is mamas and daddies to find the encouragement and the satisfaction and joy of being down there at God's house and being with God's people. Listen, we could train our kids up to catch a ball, to throw a ball, to hit a ball, to kick a ball, or to do whatever. But if we don't teach them about Jesus, we failed them miserably. Amen. You gotta know. It's always good to see kids that can do both. You know, they have to work. I remember when I was a youth guy at Camp Pinckney, we had these little sheets for kids if they couldn't come to church. And they wanted to be at church, but they had a ball game or something else. They'd take these little sheets with them, and they'd do Bible study on the buses wherever they went. That's a good thing. Kept them involved. But see, it's work. And a kid that does both, that's good stuff. Because listen, mamas and daddies, you're not only teaching them to stick to some things, but to honor God while they're doing it. It's not wrong. Listen, it ain't wrong to play travel ball. Don't get me wrong. It's not wrong to want to do those things. Those are great. But don't you sideline. Don't you sideline the ministry of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ so that your hope they might be the next Joe Montana or LeBron James. Listen, you teach them about Jesus. You let them be in favor with their Creator God. You let them seek after God and long after the things of God in the midst of it. I remember winning a young man to the Lord one time. He had a scholarship to go to the University of Georgia, and he was still in high school, and he said, "Brother Ray, what do I do now?" He got there, he said, "Brother Ray, what do I do now?" I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "Well, I'm saved." He said, "Do I go on to school? What do I do?" He thought he had to be a preacher. If he got saved, he had to be a preacher. I said, "No, man." I said, "Serve Jesus. Go to Georgia and serve Jesus, man. They need Christians up there at that place. Serve Jesus wherever you go." And I tell you today, don't be afraid, but be available. Look at verse 38. Then said Mary to the angel, verse 34, then said Mary to the angel, "How shall this be, seeing I know not a man?" And the angel answered and said unto her, "The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee." This is a Christmas sermon, isn't it? Almost. Wouldn't y'all like to sing Christmas songs other than at Christmas? Anybody? Brantley? Let me think about it. Okay. And the angel answered and said unto her, "The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the high shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, she hath also conceived a son in her old age. And this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For with God nothing shall be impossible." Woo-hoo! That's good right there. Whatever you're going through, like I tell you, with God, nothing's impossible. What you think that person you wondered about if they could ever be saved or if they'll ever have their heart right, if they'll ever get their life right, nothing's impossible with God. We waited 14 years for children. for God to send us a child. Nothing's impossible. Right when we got to the end of ours, God picked up. Right when we got to the back end of thinking that we could do it all, God showed out. I know other people that have been in the same predicament, the same boat, that God did things when they got to the end of their rope. Some of you may be here today just like that with issues about your work, with your job, with your money, with your whatever. Could it be that God's trying to get you to the end of what you can do? To get you to the place where you'll listen to Him and let Him be God? And let Him be in charge? Listen, you have to be available for God to do those things to you. Watch what it says here in verse 38. And Mary said, "Behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word." And the angel departed from her. So Mary agreed. She said, "I'll do it." She said, "I'll do it." She said, "I'll be your handmaid. I'll be your servant, and I'll do whatever you want, God." Hey, have you ever told God that in your lifetime? Or have you somehow kind of fell into this Christianity thing and now been walking the walk, trying to walk a chalk line now for the past 25 or 30 years? Could it be that God wants a relationship with you? One, you can talk to Him, He can talk to you. One, you can complain, He can tell you to stop complaining. One, where you can whine, He can tell you to stop whining. One, you can get angry, and He can tell you, hey, don't sin. You know, all those things happen. See, I remember in a relationship with my Heavenly Father. I've made myself available to be used by my Heavenly Father. Have you? Listen, I'm not saying any different than anybody else in here. But I can promise you, God will put you in a place and get you to a spot where you can be good for the kingdom if you make yourself available. Some of us wonder why God never uses. You don't make yourself available. You say, "Well, bro, what's that mean?" You got to get your heart clean. Listen, there's some things in there that you know that ought not be there. Listen, God ain't going to use that. We get our lives in a mess, and we flip it upside down, and it gets so ungod. The only thing like God, and then we want God somehow to come in there and straighten all that mess out. Listen, could it be that God wants us to get on our knees and ask for some forgiveness? Lord, we're sorry. It's one of the things that people don't do nowadays either. They don't apologize very much. Mary's response said, "I am the Lord's servant. May your word to me be fulfilled." Her understanding that it's not her ability that mattered to God. It was her availability. It wasn't her ability or how good she was. Mary wasn't, they didn't have this big long distance run and Mary come out first. They didn't have a big crocheting class and Mary was the best crocheter. God picked her out of all the ladies and all the girls and all the people and decided to bless her. Had nothing to do with her great abilities. You okay? It had something to do with the God that wanted to do a work in her. So if you're here this morning and you say, "Brother Ray, if I was better at this, then I'd help with that." No. Just make yourself available. God will make you better at things that you need to be doing at church. God, listen, God will equip you. Some of you are worried about your strength in motherhood. Listen, you just honor God and love on those children, correct them. Hey, let other folks correct them. You may have been whipped by a neighbor. Hey, man. Listen, I got all kinds of stories. My mama's here. I don't want to hurt her feelings. But, hey, growing up, we got it from everybody. And we got it everywhere. We got it in the store, didn't we, Mama? We got it in the store. We got it at church. We got it at the house. We got it at the aunts. We got it at the house. We got it at the barn, at the clothesline. It was just wherever there was something that you get hit with. Repeatedly, you know. What'd you get whipped with? Switches, shoes, drop cords, a cup. There's no telling. You know, but you look back, and I bet she had to pray as she was trying to raise three boys. I bet there's some mamas in here right now just wondering if they're doing it the right way. Hey, you just keep honoring God. You just keep putting God first, and God will make you the mama that you want to be. You just keep putting God first and God will keep showing. God will keep giving direction. Just hang in there. It'll get easier. You know, some of y'all mamas is raising teenagers. Woo. Some of you got teenagers coming up. And some of them can be hard to deal with, amen? They know everything. Teenagers, here they are up here. All of them pretty going, no. Listen, they know everything at this age. You know, just show them that they don't. They're not too old to be scolded and not too old to get in trouble. Amen. Sometimes when opportunities present themselves to us, we can feel inadequate and question our suitability for the task. But Mary's example teaches us that we make ourselves available to God. He will use us regardless of how equipped we feel. I can remember the first time I ever got up and spoke, I thought I couldn't do it. It was on a Wednesday night, and I just showed up after work, and I was dirty from work. Brother E.C. said, how about you come up and preach tonight? That was the best thing he could have done because I was not ready. And if I'd had time to think about it, I'd have come up, but I had the flu, I'd have had polio, I'd have had all kind of stuff by the time it was time to preach that next week. But I come into church, have my Bible. He said, how about you preach tonight? I said, I'll do it. You know. And I spoke that night, and I'll never forget that God equipped us. First time I had time to study, I preached where Jesus walked on water two times. I didn't realize that Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John was just from their idea of the writing, they talked about the situations that Jesus was in. I thought he walked on water twice. He might have walked on it 10 times. But they recorded it two different times of the same instant. Some of y'all think it's different now, don't you? But listen, I remember coming out of church that day, Chad, Mr. Gene Cruz, remember Mr. Gene? Old big deep voice. Mr. Gene Cruz said, I like the way you said Jesus walked on water twice. I said, yeah, one time over here in Matthew and one time over here in Luke, I think. He smiled. He put his arm around me. He said, now you know that's just one time. I went, hey, you know what I did? I went home with Eden. I studied it. I come back that night to church. I said, you were right. He said, it ain't no big deal. You know, I look back and I think about all the people that God has seeded into my life. How all the people... He could have blasted me. He could have laughed at me. But he let me teach his Sunday school class. Yeah. A few weeks later, I was teaching Sunday school. And they would teach me. All these men would teach me. See, when you make yourself available, God can do great things through your mamas. Mamas, God's given you a great gift. God chose you for those children. God chose you for those children. Listen, for their idiosyncrasies, for their not-headedness, is that a word, not-headedness? God chose you to be their mama. God chose you for that. And he feels like you could have done it better than anybody else. So be happy that God's at work in and around us. Amen. Not only be available, but be a vessel. Look what Mary went and did. Verse 39, Mary rose in those days and went to the hill country with haste into a city of Judah. Now, Mary was an unmarried teenager from humble beginnings, and God chose her to carry out one of the most significant tasks in the entire Bible. During the time that Mary was alive, women were not afforded the equal status to men, and there were severe consequences for a woman falling pregnant outside marriage. Despite knowing this, Mary said yes to what God was doing in her life. And not only did she say yes, but she did it in such a way that brought God glory, because she then went to her cousin's house, who was a woman that was now pregnant. Her husband was a priest, Zacharias. And she went to see her. The angel told her that your cousin's pregnant too. This is a big day. Listen, she could have went home and sat in the dark. But she said, God has decided to do something great. So watch this. So Mary goes and sees Elizabeth. Verse 40. She entered into the house of Zacharias and saluted Elizabeth. Nope. She said, hey, Aunt Elizabeth, or hey, cousin Elizabeth. Hey, Elizabeth, how are you doing? Watch what happens here. And it came to pass that when Elizabeth heard the salutation of Mary, the babe leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Ghost. Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Ghost, and she spake with a loud voice and said, blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb. You know what? You know what people need to hear today? They need to hear a little bit of exhortation. We need to tell our young ladies and our mothers how much we appreciate them and how much we love them, and let them know the work that they're doing is valuable in our sight and in our eyes. Elizabeth was lifting up Mary because of the strength that she had to have to do the job that she was doing. And whence is this to me that the mother of the Lord shall come to me? The mother of my Lord shall come to me. For lo, as soon as the voice of thy salutation sounded in mine ears, the babe leapt in my womb for joy. And blessed is she that believed, for there shall be a performance of those things which were told to her from the Lord. You know what she said? She said, Mary, you're going to be blessed because you obeyed God. You're going to be blessed because you obeyed God. There's some folks in here today that you're wondering how in the world God can bless where you at. It may take some time. It may take some time. You'll be fine. Listen, You know, he didn't make mama take her out. Amen. It's Mother's Day. But listen, Elizabeth told Mary, she said, listen, God's going to perform those things he said he was going to do in your life. God's going to do them. Why? Elizabeth could speak from experience now. I wonder how many, Brother Vaughn, I wonder how many years she prayed for a child. And whenever she got to the end of what she could do, God did it. And she pulled Mary to the side and said, hey, God's going to perform everything in your life that he said he'd do. You know what we need more than ever? Is our ladies to mentor our young ladies. Amen. Let me say this. And our young ladies to listen to our ladies. They need mentoring. They need, listen, you guys need to have tea. Hang out together. See each other. Listen, you don't need to get your advice from somebody on Facebook. You don't need to throw it on Facebook and say, I don't know what. Listen, call down to church house. Call Miss Vaughn. She'll come over to your house. She'll show you how to do it. Call Miss Shug. She'll swing by. Call some of these ladies that's raised youngin' and beat butts before. They'll show you. Listen, they'll show you. Miss Shug will show you how to whip a youngin'. Listen, call Miss Shug. You know, I remember one time when I was years ago, I was the administrator over a Christian school. I don't even know why. Administrator of a Christian school, and they said that my responsibility was to paddle kids when they cut up. I said, okay. Brother John, that was my job. I'd roll up in there, get out, go in the office. Kids going, hey, you stroke a couple of them, you don't have to do that anymore. Coming up, what are you doing, man? Why did the teacher call you in here? You beat the butt. Listen, those kids today, those same kids today, man, I love them. They still call me Brother Ray. Why? Love on them little fellas and let them know this is the way to do it. We need a group of people that are still teaching our younger folks how to do it. Our hope is that Emma raises her children the way we raised her. That's my goal. Listen, your parents, the people, the mamas that have been here and maybe have grandchildren or great-grandchildren, your desire is for your children to continue to do the same things you did. Listen, if you're in here with your mother right now, you ought to be thanking God that your mama had enough grit to make you do it the right way. Hey, I'm glad I didn't always have an option. My mom and dad didn't give me an option. You went to church. You did it this way. You went out and got a job. When you turned 21, you had to go. These are things that was in our lives. And I look back. Those are the greatest of lessons. Those are the greatest of lessons. So, yeah, listen, young mamas, please, look at these mamas that have done it. Don't get all bogged down in the new age Mamas for Dummies. Or is that book? You know, what's that book? Some of y'all seen it. Miss Shug had a book. She called it the Bible. What was it that was called? Pregnancy for Dummies. You know, listen. There may be some things. Listen, you know what you need to do? You need to be listening to your mama or maybe your grandmama or her aunt. Maybe you didn't have a good godly influence around you, but I promise you, God will put somebody there for you if you look for it. How about that? How about this? Not only be a vessel, but be faithful. Be joyous. I'm going to finish up right here. Look at verse 46. Boy, Mary was all happy. She hadn't had the baby yet. She was probably still under some retribution, and she was probably getting looks, and people was gawking at her. Joseph said he loved her anyway, and he trusted God. So you got this core group of people that's trusting and loving God, and they're being bombarded by the world. Can you see it? Can you see it? It's kind of where we're at today. Lord, help us stick to some things. Watch this. Mary's song of praise in verse 46. And Mary said, Mary was a vessel, but she was faithful and she was joyous. Though let me say it this way. I've not always agreed with everything that's come out of the Vatican, but the Pope said something 7 years ago. Said he thinks that Mary's greatest asset was her faith. It was because of her faith that she could stick to the stuff in the midst of all the people that no doubt were shouting against her. She claimed to carry the Son of God. Are you okay? She claimed to carry the Son of God. Mary said, "My soul doth magnify the Lord." She said, "My soul doth magnify the Lord." Can you just imagine? "And my spirit hath rejoiced in God my Savior. For he hath regarded the low estate of his handmaiden. For behold, from henceforth all generations shall call me blessed." She realized that God had put her in a place that she was going to be blessed. That people in generations come. They might not see it in her generation, but God, through her, was building shade trees for another generation to be able to come and get up under and get faith from. "For he that is mighty hath done to me great things, and holy is his name," she says. Watch this. "And his mercy is on them that fear him from generation to generation. And he hath showed strength with his arm, and he hath scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He hath put down the mighty from their seats and exalted them of low degree. He hath filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he hath sent empty away. He hath hope in his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, as he spake to our fathers, to Abraham and to his seed forever." Bible says in verse 56, "And Mary abode with her about 3 months and returned to her own house." She stayed there just long enough, just up to the birth of John the Baptist. And she went home. She went home. This morning, there's some people here that you may be afraid, you may worry, and you're not sure. Can I tell you that God knows your situation? It hadn't snuck up on you, and no matter what you're going through, and no matter what you're holding against somebody else, God knows. God knows where you're at. God knows your predicaments. Could it be that God's allowed you to get into a spot where you can cry out for him? Could it be that that fear that you feel is the trigger God's going to use to bring you closer to him? Could be. It finally could be that pressure put on you to where you move closer to the King of God. This could be your day. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you so much for all that we've seen here today in your church. And Lord, for Mother's Day and those that are here. Lord, I lift up those mamas, God, that have done it the right way for years and years and years. That, Lord, have mentored all these young ladies and, Lord, have helped them through some things. God, we pray, Lord, that you'll continue to bless and direct our senior adult ladies and our mamas. And just thank you, God, for all of our new mothers, Lord, who are fearful, who are worried, who have worries of inadequacy and all those things, God. Lord, I pray you'll bless them. Lord, and give them peace. Give them assurances that their church is with them. Lord, my prayer today is for somebody here that needs you. For somebody here today that wants to pray for somebody. God, I pray that today they'll do it. Lord, forgive us of our sins. Lord, the very God that Mary cried out to is our God. The very creator that she cried out to is our creator. And the very Jesus that she bore was our sacrifice for our sins. So God, thank you so much for all that you've done for us here today. Help us to be grateful for what we have. In Jesus' name, amen. If you would, please stand. If you'd like to come today, please do. Do you need Jesus? Is there some things that need to be forgiven? Is there a place of worry that you need some help with? Are you afraid? It's okay to be afraid. God wants to help you. God wants to help you. God wants to help you with some peace and some direction. That's not just for mamas. I hope God's speaking to you today. I hope we listen. I hope we listen. God good. Mother's Day today. If your mother's still alive, if your mother's still on this side, be thankful. Be thankful that you get to have one more phone call, one more moment. And don't take those days for granted. Before you know, they'll be gone. Before you know, they'll be gone. And you'll be looking forward to seeing them in heaven again one day. So for those of you here that mamas have already gone home to be with the Lord, you can know there's a great reunion day one day. You'll get to see him again if you're ready. If you're ready. A young man in Folkestone passed away this week, and several people was asking, was he ready? Was he ready? Everybody's rushing, oh, was he ready? Was he ready? I told somebody this week, I said, you know, your concern should have been for him last week. Your concern for him should have been last week. Don't take for granted anything. I don't assume anybody in this building saved. I don't assume I'm preaching to a bunch of saved people. When I look out there, I see a bunch of L's on everybody's forehead. Lost. Lost. Because I think there's a bunch of lost people in our churches today. And I want to preach every week and maybe dig one of you out of your pew so that you can go to heaven when I go. It's important. Amen. Anybody have anything to say before we dismiss? We don't have church this afternoon, so you can go spend time with your mamas if you'd like to, and go over and bother them and hug their neck and love on them and do that. That'd be good if you could do that. I'm looking forward to spending time with ours. Pray for my daddy. He was coming over here with mama today and got the shakes, probably because he didn't have all his coffee or he had too much coffee. But he's at Jonathan's house now, so y'all keep him in your prayers. Anybody else? Youth parent meeting in the youth room right after church. Anybody else? If not, Brother Randy, would you dismiss us in prayer, please, sir?